To our new McKendree online worship community. I'm Pastor Brian Wendland, and I pray that you all are safe, that you're well, and I pray that you're ready to worship. We'll get started in a few minutes, but in the meantime, please take a moment to join our Facebook watch party. And be sure to like it and then share it with your Facebook friends. You can also use this time for a little fellowship, online fellowship, by greeting folks, worshiping with you in the comments. If you're watching on YouTube, I invite you to subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the notification bell. Also, don't forget to register your attendance via the Connect card on our new McKendree app. You can also submit your prayer request via the Connect card. We'll get our worship started promptly at our regular worship times. That'd be 5 p.m. if you're worshiping with us this Saturday, or 9 a.m. or 10:30 a.m. for our Sunday morning worshipers. We'll see you in a few minutes. Grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with each of you. My name is Pastor Brian Wendley. And whether you're a member of New McKendree or new to us and joining online from near or far, welcome. Welcome to Jackson, Missouri's New McKendree United Methodist Church. It's an honor to worship with you today. If you haven't already done so, please go ahead and register your attendance via the Connect card on our New McKendree app. You can also send us your prayer requests via the Connect card. And while you've got the app open, feel free to go ahead and make your offering. There'll also be time set aside for you to do so later in our worship service. So here we are, coronavirus internet worship week number 12. But as anyone who's checked out our June newsletter knows, there's light at the end of the tunnel. And since all the pertinent info is in the newsletter, and since my greetings and announcements seem to be getting longer and longer every week, I'm going to keep today short. But for those who haven't seen the newsletter yet, here's the punchline. Our first weekend back worshiping together under the same roof will be on July 4th and 5th. That's right. Unless something changes, God forbid, Independence Day weekend will be our first time worshiping together since March 15th. And as has already been mentioned several times over the past few weeks, all the services will be offered at our South Campus facility. We'll offer a traditional service at 5 p.m. on Saturday, July 4th, and a 9 a.m. traditional service and a 10:30 a.m. contemporary service on Sunday, July 5th. All three at South Campus. That's the big news. Please be sure to check out all the pertinent particulars in our June newsletter. Suffice it to say that although it'll be great to get us back to normal, it'll be a much different normal than we enjoyed before the COVID thing hit. But God's got this, and it'll be great. Pastor Charles will get us started with a prayer in just a minute. But first, a word from our incredible children's ministry team. We'll see you in a few.
Church family, we hope you're having a great Sunday morning. If you're a kid or if you have kids, make sure you check out our Sunday morning video lessons. We post these every Sunday morning at 8 a.m. on the New McKendree page and the New McKendree Kids page. We love seeing kids and families participating and reading their Bibles together. It's a great opportunity for your family to grow in their faith, all while spending time together. And of course, we're spotlighting our New McKendree Kid of the Week in the video, so make sure to comment and tell them how awesome they did.
Here's to you, you were pink or blue, and everything I wanted. Here's to you, never sleeping through, from midnight till the morning. Had to crawl before you walked, before you ran, before I knew it. You were trying to free your fingers from my hand, 'cause you could do it on your own. You stay here a minute more. I know you wanna walk through the door, but it's all too fast. Let's make it last a little while. I pointed to the sky, and now you wanna fly. I am your biggest fan. I hope you know I am. But do you think you can serve? Slow down. Here's to you, every missing tooth, every bedtime story. Here's to Barbie cars, lightsaber wars, sleeping in on Sunday. Had to crawl before you walked, before you ran. Before I knew it, you were teaching me the only thing love can. Hold hands through it when it's scary. You've got me. Let's slow down. Won't you stay here a minute more? I know you wanna walk through the door, but it's all too fast. Let's make it last a little while. I pointed to the sky, and now you wanna fly. I am your biggest fan, I hope you know I am. But do you think you can somehow slow down? Let's slow down. Won't you stay here a minute more? I know you wanna walk through the door, but it's all too fast. Let's make it last a little while. I pointed to the sky, and now you wanna fly. I am your biggest fan.
Welcome to our New McKendry Weekend Worship Services. My name is Charles Buck, and I'm involved with the hospitality, connecting, and volunteer ministries of our church. And we're delighted that you have joined us by YouTube, Facebook, or radio today with our worship services. We hope that you will receive encouragement and you will inspiration for living your life as we are living today, almost away from each other at times, but yet together in spirit and in love. As we approach our time of worship, I ask that you join with me in a word of prayer. O God, be present with us always, dwell within our hearts, with your light and your spirit. Guide our souls, our thoughts, and all our actions, that we may teach your word, that your healing power may be in us and in your church throughout the world. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. I thought we would just sing a couple of songs this morning that speak to our great need for Jesus. So let's sing these songs together.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Let's sing that. Open the eyes of my heart. Sing it.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
High and lifted.
To see you high and lifted up, shining with the light of your glory. Pour out your power in love as we sing holy, holy, holy.
Open the eyes of our hearts.
Open the eyes of my heart.
Feet
of Jesus, the greatness of His mercy and love at the feet of Jesus. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lamb.
We fall down.
We fall down.
Psalmist said, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, who is good, whose steadfast love endures forever." Today, as we pray together, we're aware that so much is going on in our world, and yet the God we serve never changes. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Today on our prayer list, we have Glenn Fox, Mary Shelton, Lynn Hanquist, Caitlin Burris, Kobe Steyer, and Tim Tushoff, and along with many other concerns we have in our families, in our society, in our world. Together, let us pray and remember that God is a good God and promised never to leave us nor forsake us. Let us pray. Eternal God, giver of all good gifts, we gather today to give you thanks and praise for the precious gift of life and the promises of everlasting life. As we pray together, we're reminded that we're not alone, even amidst all of the uncertainties of our day. You're with us. Sometimes we forget and we try to go it alone. And then we realize that it's because of God's grace that we can overcome. So together we shall overcome and we will overcome. So today we pray not only for each other, but we reach out to those especially who've requested prayer of the church. May your Holy Spirit touch them in ways to bring peace and goodwill and bring healing in their lives. What we ask for these precious ones who request prayer, we pray for all today that's our duty to pray for. We pray for the members of the church. We pray for Christians everywhere. And may your Holy Spirit grant peace and bring strength to all of us during this time of great trial. For it's because we serve you, Lord, we recognize that we're never alone. It's in that spirit we come today and pray that your will be done as we lift our prayers together, praying the prayer you taught us to pray, praying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom of power and the glory are yours, now and forever and ever." And all of God's people together say amen and amen.
The scriptures today are taken from 2 Chronicles chapter 7 verse 14 and Luke chapter 18 verses 9 through 14. Then if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sins and restore their land. Then Jesus told this story to some who had great confidence in their own righteousness and scorned everyone else. Two men went to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee and the other was a despised tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed this prayer: I thank you, God, that I am not like other people, cheaters, sinners, adulterers. I'm certainly not like that tax collector. I fast twice a week, and I give you a tenth of my income. But the tax collector stood at a distance and dared not even lift his eyes to heaven as he prayed. Instead, he beat his chest in sorrow, saying, O God, be merciful to me, for I am a sinner. I tell you, this sinner, not the Pharisee, returned home justified before God. For those who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
What an amazing, troublesome, and trying time our community, our great nation, and really our entire planet has gone through just in the first half of 2020. The year started innocently enough. The economy was expanding, unemployment was lower than it had been in decades. Best of all, the Kansas City Chiefs won the Super Bowl. Closer to home, all seemed well in Jackson. Kids were in school learning and teachers were in school teaching. Even closer to home, our New McHenry church family had been blessed with an incredible 2019, and 2020 was on its way to being another vibrant year of both spiritual and numerical growth. Established ministry programs were growing, and new outreach ministries, such as our budding relationship with Jackson Junior High School, was beginning to flourish. But then, about the second week in March, the COVID hit the fan, so to speak. By the third week in March, our church and churches across the nation were forced to completely reinvent not just the way we worship, but the way we do church overall. And I don't know if you've ever stopped to think about it, but the magnitude and the significance of those wholesale changes that our church and churches, Christian churches everywhere, were forced to navigate in just a few short weeks, that kind of blow your mind. I can tell you for sure that every person who writes clergy on their tax return knows that, and because they experienced the magnitude and the significance of those changes firsthand. I can't speak for others, but there were times in late March and early April when I felt like I was driving a bus with no steering wheel. But God's grace is more than sufficient. God graces New McHenry Church family with the blessing of a passionate, never-say-die staff and a congregation of praying, resilient, encouraging, and loving disciples. We all hate that this microscopic coronavirus devil has taken 500,000 lives and left a wake of destruction for those of us it didn't kill. But nonetheless, I can't help but feel like we're starting to finally see some light at the end of the tunnel. And what's more, as I've reflected upon the way our New McHenry Church family has weathered this storm thus far, I'm overwhelmed with gratitude, praise, and pride. The gratitude and praise, of course, go to God for providing us with the grace, wisdom, and courage to carry on. The feelings of pride are aimed at you, my New McHenry Church family, for your ongoing support and for the way that you continually love and care for one another. Anyway, as true as all that is, everything I've said thus far was going to be the introduction to a sermon that I started writing two and a half weeks ago. But in the face of the self-inflicted tragedy that's currently ravaging our great nation, what I was going to talk about somehow seems irrelevant and borderline inappropriate. My rah-rah, thank God COVID's on the run sermon lost its relevance the day that George Floyd died in broad daylight at the hand of a police officer in Midtown Minneapolis. Like you, I was saddened by the news. But upon seeing the video of Mr. Floyd face down, handcuffed, and gasping for air as a police officer,
A man who swore an oath to protect and serve took a knee on the man's carotid artery. My sadness then turned from anger to heartbroken sadness. I don't know how any of us can see that image and not be heartbroken. Heartbroken for the man whose life was taken by an officer entrusted with the sacred duty of protecting. Heartbroken for the Mr. Floyd's family, who will never be able to unsee their loved one being publicly robbed of his life and dignity. And heartbroken for the image that video says about the state of our otherwise great nation. You know, I'm coming up on the end of my second year as your pastor, and although it's a pretty short time in the big scheme of things, I know I've mentioned this more than a few times that this pulpit is not the place for me to push my personal political opinions. This isn't my pulpit, nor is it your pulpit. It's God's pulpit, and it solely exists for the proclamation of God's truth. Having said that, there's really no risk at this point of me pushing my opinions on this particular matter because I'm still trying to process it, still trying to get my head around it. All I know is that I'm heartbroken over the whole thing. And based on the numerous conversations I've had with many of our church family members this past week, I'm not the only one whose day is confused and heartbroken. Like I said, I'm still processing. But one thing's for sure, we're living in a divided nation. And the horrible death of George Floyd points to a divisive reality that's really bigger and more chronic than even that single horrible event. We're racially divided. We're ideologically divided. We're evidently morally divided to the point that citizens rightfully exercising their First Amendment right to protest have been hijacked by mobs of violent looting, burning, and vandalizing people. People that are vandalizing our nations into oblivion. I can't help but think that this cancerous divisiveness, if left unchecked, will literally eat our otherwise great nation alive. As Christians, as members of the body of Christ, living here in Jackson, Missouri, what are we to make of all this? Are we to write this off as a big city problem and then just pray to God that St. Louis keeps their problems in St. Louis and then stay down here and hope for the best? After all, we don't have racial problems in Jackson, right? Racial problems. You know, I've been thinking and praying a lot about that very topic. From my vantage point, we don't have racial problems in Jackson. But then it occurred to me, how would I know if there was racial problems? I'm a white guy living in a predominantly white community. That's not a good thing, it's not a bad thing, and I'm not apologizing for it, it just is. I'm white, and according to U.S. Census data, so are 96% of my Jackson neighbors. I bring this up because maybe we who are in the 96th percentile are the wrong ones to ask about racial equality. I'm not saying all this to say that we're a bigoted community. I'm just saying that it's hard for us to identify with the day-to-day experiences of people of other races while living in a community that, for the most part, has no other races. I'll illustrate what I mean, what I'm getting at, with a thought that hit me like a sledgehammer in the forehead during my Wednesday morning prayer time. I was reading and praying, and as one would expect, my ADD kicked in, and my mind began to wander to a hypothetical what-if scenario that went something like this. I imagined that I was a black man, a black dad, raising two teenage sons. We'll call them Andy and Jake, which coincidentally are the names of my two non-hypothetical sons. I imagined that the three of us, watching TV, suddenly breaking news flash interrupts our show with the news of George Floyd's death, accompanied by the video of the police officer who doesn't look like me and my boys crushing the life out of a handcuffed man who does look like me and my boys. Now keep in mind, my hypothetical sons are teenagers. Now I imagine the three of us watching the atrocity, and then, rather than my teenage boys listening to the news talking heads to tell them what to think, they turn to me, their dad. They turn to me, their African-American dad, to help them process and react to what they perceive to be a racially motivated atrocity. So, in my hypothetical what-if scenario, I tried to think through what fatherly advice I might offer my two impassioned and rightfully offended sons. And that's where my hypothetical what-if exercise fell apart. It fell apart because I'm a white dad who raised two white boys. I'm not apologizing for it, and it's not a bad thing, it just is. But it does mean that I have absolutely no idea what I would say to my two African-American boys. Not a clue. Sure, I know all about being a dad and raising boys. And sure, any human being with half a brain and half a heart, if they saw what happened in Minneapolis, they would agree that that was a horrific tragedy. But I have no way of relating to what it feels like to be an African-American man, let alone an African-American dad, in the midst of all this. I simply have no frame of reference. And why would I? So what can we do? Is there anything we can do? Since we'll never, ever be able to truly relate to those who don't look like us or believe like us or think like us, does that mean that we're doomed to our cancerous divisiveness? You know, maybe it's the glass half full optimist in me speaking here, but my gut says no. More importantly, I believe that Scripture says no as well. And what's more, I think a good place for us to start is with what Jesus says to us by way of the parable of the Pharisee and the tax collector. And here's what I mean by that. Notice how the parable begins. The narrator, Luke, informs us right off the bat as to who this story is aimed at. Then Jesus told this story to some who had great confidence in their own righteousness and scorned everybody else. As it relates to the original context, Jesus' words were aimed at self-righteous religious elites who held in contempt anyone who didn't look, act, or think like them. Calling them by name, Jesus says, the Pharisee stood by himself and prayed this prayer. Now, using your imagination for a minute, imagine if the context of Jesus' parable wasn't first century Palestine, but rather 21st century U.S. of A. Since Pharisees aren't a thing in this day and age, who do you think Jesus would be aiming at? Who are the self-righteous people in this country who don't bother to view people as individuals created in God's image, but rather as other people? Other people who, because they don't think, act, or look like you, are therefore inferior. You know, let's be humble and honest with ourselves. In fact, now might be a good time to hit the pause button and go grab a mirror from the bathroom. If Jesus were here telling this story today, who do you think he might aim his story at? Well, using good old army terminology, I'm thinking it'd be a target-rich environment. We become a country of divided-up people who are all using the same playbook, the Pharisee playbook. We're all huddled up in our own groups, clinging to our own version of righteousness, convinced that all the other groups are inferior because they don't think, act, or look like us. For a few, that way of thinking is conscious and overt. For most, including me perhaps, I suspect it's a subconscious reality, and therefore probably a more insidious reality. I wonder how Jesus would have worded the self-righteous prayer if he were telling this story today. The conservative Republican prayed this prayer, "I thank God I'm not like those other people." You could fill in the blanks. The progressive liberal prayed this prayer, "I thank God I'm not like those people." Fill in the blanks. The white person prayed this prayer, "I thank God I'm not like those people." The African American prayed this prayer, "I thank God I'm not like those people." The police officer prayed this prayer, "I thank God I'm not like other people." The Jackson, Missouri, New McKinder United Methodist prayed this prayer, "I thank God I'm not like those people." Like I said, back in first century Palestine, the Pharisees had pretty much cornered the market on self-righteousness. In our here and now 21st century world, Jesus would have had many targeting opportunities. And since every group thinks they own the patent on God's righteousness, how can we not be divided? But thankfully, Jesus' parable offers us an alternative. You see, unlike the Pharisees, and obviously unlike us, Jesus doesn't look out into the world and see other people. Jesus sees people one person at a time. Rather than grouping people by color and pedigree and politics, Jesus sees individual people, each one uniquely and wonderfully made in his Father's image. And that really rings out loud and clear in his description of the tax collector. You see, while the Pharisee looked at the other person praying in the temple, when he looked at him, he didn't see a person at all. He saw a homogeneous member of a cheating, sinning, adulterous tax collector class. What Jesus saw wasn't a tax collector, but a child of God pleading for mercy. The Pharisee approached God with resume in hand as a member of the elite Pharisee club. By all indications, the tax collector appealed to God simply as a sinner and offered nothing but humble plea for mercy. I wonder what might happen if each and every one of us took a time out from our self-righteous group affiliations long enough to follow the lead of the tax collector. In other words, what would happen if we all abandoned our Pharisee-style, conservative, liberal, black, white, gay, straight, righteousness groups and simply appealed to God based on the one and only thing that we all share in common? The reality that underneath all those labels, we're all just sinners in need of God's mercy. According to Jesus, God doesn't need us to update him on the sins of others. God's looking for us to acknowledge and humbly admit our own sin, one sin at a time. That's the one and only way that we'll be justified before God. And if that's true, and I know in my heart that it is, then perhaps each of us pleading one person at a time for God's mercy is where we can begin to heal the cancerous divisiveness that's eating our otherwise great nation alive. We may never be able to fully relate to what it's like to be a person of another race or another ideology, but if we start with the one reality that we do all share, the reality that we're sinners in need of God's mercy, then God promises to take care of the rest. And how do I know that? Because God's word says so in 2 Chronicles 7. If my people, who are called by my name, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear them from heaven and will forgive their sins and will restore their land. My prayer is that each of us will turn to God as the humble tax collector did, seeking forgiveness for our self-righteous Pharisee that's within each of us and plead for mercy. And if we do, God will take care of the rest. He'll take care of our great nation, and he'll take care of each one of us who are blessed to call it home. Amen and amen.
I cannot stand, I'll fall on you.
Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you. Cause Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I Jesus Christ, my living hope.
We come to the end of another worship service, and as our pastor has challenged us today, we go from this place where we may be, in our homes, wherever we may be today, we go out in the world to proclaim the good news that Jesus Christ is Lord. We go knowing that we're not alone. We're in the presence of a God who promises never to leave us nor forsake us. A God the same yesterday, today, and forever. Now go in peace, and may the blessing of the Lord be our strength and guide today and always. And all of God's children are ready to say amen and amen and amen.
Presence of my enemies, I raise a hallelujah.
Come on,
louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah.